Take your hymnals, please, and we're going to be singing hymn number 79, To God Be the Glory. Hymn number 79, when you have that, please stand with me.
If you would turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, we're keeping you on your toes this morning. Matthew chapter 5, we're going to be reading together verses 1 through 12. If you have the Black Pew Bible, it's page 960. 960 in the Black Pew Bible. And we're going to be reading together Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. He opened his mouth and began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." You may be seated. If you turn with me again in your hymn books to hymn number 385, I'll have you sit, but You got to make sure you sing out, though. All right. And let's go ahead and sing hymn number 385. And let's sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Okay. Excellent singing. Let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll have the men come forward for the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, and thank you for all that you have given us. We thank you for the opportunity to come together and meet. We thank you for the opportunity to sing praises to you, to give to you, and then also to learn from your word. I pray that you would bless the tithes and offerings this morning, that would be used to further your name, not only here, but throughout New Hampshire and beyond. I pray that you would help us to trust you in times of plenty and during times of great need. I pray that you would help us as we live our lives, that we would do so in a way that shows the hope that we have in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sarah. You might have noticed we flipped our scripture reading, so I'm going to be reading for us out of Psalm 57, the 57th Psalm, and I will read out loud. You can follow along silently or just listen as I read Psalm 57. For the choir director set to Al-Tashheth, a miktam of David, when he fled from Saul in the cave. Be gracious to me, O God, be gracious to me, for my soul takes refuge in you. and in the shadow of your wings I will take refuge until destruction passes by. I will cry to God Most High, the God who accomplishes all things for me. He will send from heaven and save me. He reproaches him who tramples upon me. Selah. God will send forth his loving kindness and his truth. My soul is among lions. I must lie among those who breathe forth fire, even the sons of men, whose teeth are spears and arrows, and their tongue a sharp sword. Be exalted above the heavens, O God. Let your glory be above all the earth. They have prepared a net for my steps. My soul is bowed down. They dug a pit before me. They themselves have fallen into the midst of it. Selah. My heart is steadfast, O God. My heart is steadfast. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises. Awake, my glory. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your loving kindness is great to the heavens, and your truth to the clouds. Be exalted above the heavens, O God. Let your glory be above all the earth. Take your hymnals one more time, please, and we're singing not the one that's listed in the bulletin, but rather 529. 529. When you have that hymn, stand with me, please. 529.
Thank you.
may be seated.
Open your Bibles with me, please, to Psalm 57. Psalm 57, we're interrupting our Matthew series. I was planning up until about 8 o'clock last night to do part of the Beatitudes this morning and decided, you know what, I think the Lord would rather have us do something else. And so we're in Psalm 57 this morning, in the shadow of God's wings. Much of David's life, if you think about it, was a life of uncertainty. He spent a lot of the early years of his life running from the madman King Saul, living in caves and different places around the wilderness of Judea, and even having to flee outside of Israeli territory to the Philistines. Even after he became king, there were two times when he had to flee for his life, once from his own son Absalom, who coveted his throne. David knew something about uncertainty and doubt. And in the superscription of Psalm 57 that we read a moment ago, you might have noticed this strange Hebrew, Al-Tashheth. The superscriptions, we believe, are original to the text. And so they were part of the accepted canon of Scripture. In other words, they're inspired. They're part of God's Word. Many of these markings like this, you can even look back at Psalm 56 and see another one to the choir director, according to Jonath Elem Rahakim. Those are often tune names. So David and other psalmists, David and other song writers would compose the lyrics, and then they would indicate, I want this to be set to this particular tune. So actually, in our hymnal, you can look often at the bottom of the page and see there the person who wrote the words and the person who wrote the music. Sometimes over on the right-hand bottom side, you'll see there's a name, and that's the name of the tune. And you can sometimes have a tune that will fit more than one set of lyrics. And that's true of the Psalms as well. So it's possible that Al-Tashheth is the name of the tune. It's also possible that it describes this period of David's life when he was fleeing from Saul. Al-Tashheth means do not destroy. And that certainly would be the prayer of David's heart, because Saul was trying to kill him on many, many occasions. So this tune name, by the way, shows up in 58 and 59 Psalms as well. So David knew something about uncertainty. He knew something about living with the fear of death. He knew something about wondering what is going to happen tomorrow. And the particular time that this is composed, we do have a marker for it. So in that superscription, you might notice at the heading of Psalm 57, a miktam, that means a teaching song of David when he fled from Saul in the cave. So keep your finger here, but flip over to 1 Samuel 24, 1 Samuel chapter 24, and you can see the occasion when this occurred. So, 1 Samuel 24, looking at verse 1, now when Saul returned from pursuing the Philistines, he was told, saying, behold, David is in the wilderness of En-Gedi. Then Saul took 3,000 chosen men from all Israel and went to seek David and his men in front of the rocks of the wild goats. He came to the sheepfolds on the way, and where there was a cave, and Saul went in to relieve himself. Now David and his men were sitting in the inner recesses of the cave. And you remember the story that David's men said to him, this is your chance, you can kill him. And David said, no, I will not lift my hand against the Lord's anointed. He did cut off the hem of Saul's garment. Well, this seems to be the time here. If we were to read the rest of 1 Samuel 24, we're not going to now, but if we were to read that, we'd find out that Saul went down the hillside, and David waited until he was down quite a little ways away, and he came out, and he called out, my lord the king. Saul turned around, and David said, I could have killed you, and I didn't. Why are you chasing me? Why are you trying to kill me? What am I, a dead dog, a flea? Why are you looking for me like this? I could have killed you, and I didn't, because I intend you no harm. Saul actually wept. He started crying because he knew he was in the wrong. And he had some sense, apparently. He was, by this time, he was nearly always insane. Who looks for... David is actually his best friend. Saul doesn't even know it. But Saul had some inkling of what was going to happen, because at the end of that conversation, he called out to David and he said, "When you become king, I'm asking, would you swear an oath to me that you will not hunt down and kill all of my descendants?" Because that would be normal. That would be the normal thing that would happen. And David did actually take that oath. By the way, he fulfilled that oath. Do you remember the young man's name? Mephibosheth, Jonathan's son. He did fulfill that oath. Well, David knows something about running for his life, about being at risk of death, about wondering, where am I going to be tonight? Where am I going to try to hide out from a madman who takes 3,000 chosen elite warriors on a manhunt for one guy? Where am I going to hide? What is tomorrow going to hold? David knows something about uncertainty and about anxiety. And here in Psalm 57, we're going to be looking at this psalm to see some lessons for us. And we're going to be looking at three things. The first three verses are David's cry for grace. David's cry for grace. In verses 4 through 6, David's cause for grief. And then finally in verses 7 through 11, David's confidence in God. So notice with me first, David's cry for grace in the first three verses. Here is Psalm 57, verse 1. "Be gracious to me, O God, be gracious to me, for my soul takes refuge in you, and in the shadow of your wings I will take refuge until destruction passes by. I will cry to God Most High, to God who accomplishes all things for me. He will send from heaven and save me. He reproaches him who tramples upon me. Selah. God will send forth his loving kindness and his truth." So here's David's cry for grace. He asks God, he cries out to him, and he says, "Be gracious to me, O God, be gracious to me." God is the source of grace. In fact, Peter says in 1 Peter 5:10, "The God of all grace, he is the ultimate source of all kindness, all compassion, all love, all mercy. God is where it comes from." David knows that, and he's calling out to the Lord and saying, "I need your help. I need your grace. I need your wisdom." Smart people know when they need help. The smartest people know they need help all the time. And the smartest of the smart people know that only God can supply that need. And they turn to him. They're the ones who pray all the time, "Lord, be gracious to me. I need you. I need your love. I need your kindness. I need your wisdom." There's not a day of our lives but what we need God's grace. David knows this, and that's why he cries out. And he says, "For my soul takes refuge in you." A refuge is a place of protection, a hiding place, a shelter, a shield. And David says to God, "I'm counting on you to hide me. I'm counting on you to help me." Saul, the madman, walks through the wilderness looking for signs of David so he can kill him. You might even remember a couple of times early on in this episode, David was in Saul's palace playing the harp, trying to calm Saul down, and just out of nowhere, Saul grabs a spear and tries to pin David right to the wall. What a madman. And so David is calling out to God and saying, "My soul takes refuge in you." Protection, hiding, shelter. And now in verse 1, in the middle of the verse, we have this interesting phrase, "And in the shadow of your wings, I will take refuge." The picture, of course, is one of a mother bird gathering her chicks about her, fluffing out her wings and her feathers and pulling them in tight and close underneath her. And nothing but nothing can get at those babies because the mother bird is there protecting. That's the picture. very interesting picture, and there might actually be a bit of a family history. Keep your finger here, but flip back to the book of Ruth. Ruth chapter 2. And in Ruth chapter 2, you're going to find an interview between the man of Bethlehem named Boaz and the Moabitess named Ruth. And in Ruth chapter 2, and I'm looking at verse 11, Boaz replied to her, that's Ruth, "All that you have done for your mother-in-law after the death of your husband has been fully reported to me, and how you left your father and your mother and the land of your birth and came to a people that you did not previously know." Verse 12, "May the Lord reward your work and your wages be full from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to seek refuge." Under whose wings you have come to seek refuge. Refuge under the wings. Now look at the end of the little book of Ruth, chapter 4. And you've got a genealogy, a little mini family tree. And you can see here in verse 18, 4:18 of Ruth. "Now these are the generations of Perez. To Perez was born Hezron, and to Hezron was born Ram, and to Ram Amminadab, and to Amminadab was born Nashon, and to Nashon Salmon, and to Salmon was born Boaz, and to Boaz Obed," verse 22, "and to Obed was born Jesse, and to Jesse David." Huh. Boaz is David's great-grandfather. And David uses this phrase, "under the shadow of your wings," several times. He uses it at least three times in the book of Psalms. I wonder, and this pondering is not my own, it's from my younger brother Kurt, but I wonder if this became kind of a family saying, that in Boaz's household, this is something that you would say to encourage one another. Take shelter in the shadow of his wings. What a beautiful picture, and how very true it is. While the world is going crazy, while the world is going bonkers, we who know Jesus Christ by faith can say to each other, take shelter, take refuge in the shadow of his wings. Back in Psalm 57, "In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge until destruction passes by." Verse 2, "I will cry to God Most High, to God who accomplishes all things for me." Here's an interesting thought. How much do you think gets accomplished that hasn't been accomplished by God? So, we're hoping that our government can figure this crisis out. We're hoping that some scientist somewhere has the secret to a vaccine. We're hoping that the economy doesn't absolutely tank. We're hoping that, you know, fill in the blank. We have these hopes. But, you know, how firmly attached are we to the reality that those hopes may happen or may not? We don't know. We're uncertain. But verse 2 of Psalm 57 says, "I will cry to God Most High, to God who accomplishes all things for me." Huh. God accomplishes things. What he starts, he carries out. Do you remember John 19:30? You don't turn there. Jesus is on the cross. And he is thinking about all the other things that were necessary for him to fulfill as the Messiah. Even such things as asking for vinegar to drink. Even such things as forgiving people. Even such things as taking care of his mother and handing her care off to the youngest of his disciples, John. And he goes over in his mind, "Have I done everything that I was supposed to do
to fulfill the work of the Messiah. And when he gets to the end of the list in his mind and his heart, and he recognizes, I have done everything that the Father sent me to do. He said, it is finished. It's done. God finishes what he starts. Go with me over to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians, the first chapter, here's a great reminder of God's grace at work in us in the church age, what God is trying to do, what he wants to do in us and through us. I'm in Philippians, the first chapter, and I'm going to be looking at verse 6, Philippians 1, 6. It says, for I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. Paul says, God started a work in you. He began to do something. When you got saved, when you trusted Jesus as Savior, he began a work in you. God is not going to give up on that until it's done. The day of Christ Jesus is the bema, is the meeting with God. It's the interview with Jesus Christ himself. God started that. He's going to accomplish it. Praise the Lord. God finishes his projects. I have a barn full of projects that I have started. Would you like to know how many have gotten finished? Nah, don't ask that. God finishes what he starts. God who accomplishes all things for me. I go back to Psalm 57 again. And it says in verse 3, he will send from heaven and save me. He reproaches him with tramples upon me. And then there's this little word, Selah. The word Selah, it's very mysterious. We don't really fully comprehend what the Hebrew word means. It probably means something like, there's supposed to be a musical interlude. The music keeps on playing, the accompaniment, the harps, the strings, the music goes on playing. But the singers who are singing this song stop and they pause. And the idea is to give the hearers a few minutes, a few moments to ponder what has been said. What is the truth of what I have just been listening to? And so we pause and we think about, he, that's God, will send from heaven and save me. Those are David's words. Interestingly, we have in David's own writing a picture. It's an amazing vignette of his idea, David's picture in his mind of what happens when David calls out to God and says, Lord, I need your help. I'm in serious trouble here. If you can help me, please send help. Flip back to Psalm 18. Psalm 18. Here is a remarkable inside look. And I think it's not too much of a stretch to say, while the language here is hyperbole, it's over the top, it's amazing. Nonetheless, the tone or the truth or the reality of God's loving response to his children's cry is there. It's for real. So I'm in Psalm 18, and I'm going to look at verse 6. Psalm 18, verse 6. This is David, and he says, in my distress I called upon the Lord and cried to my God for help. He heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry for help before him came into his ears. So David says, I prayed. I called to God, and he heard, and now listen to the language of what David says God did when he heard. Verse 7, then the earth shook and quaked, and the foundations of the mountains were trembling and were shaken because he was angry. Smoke went up out of his nostrils, and fire from his mouth devoured. Coals were kindled by it. He bowed the heavens also and came down with thick darkness under his feet. He rode upon a cherub and flew, and he sped upon the wings of the wind. He made darkness his hiding place, his canopy around him, darkness of waters, thick clouds of the skies. From the brightness before him passed his thick clouds, hailstones and coals of fire. The Lord also thundered in the heavens, and the Most High uttered his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. He sent out his arrows and scattered them, and lightning flashes in abundance, and routed them. Then the channels of water appeared, and the foundations of the world were laid bare. At your rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of the breath of your nostrils, he sent from on high, he took me, he drew me out of many waters. He delivered me from my strong enemy and from those who hated me, for they were too mighty for me. They confronted me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my stay. He brought me forth also into a broad place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. Just as soon as you and I call out to God and say, Lord, I am in trouble here. I don't know how to handle this. This is too big. It's too much. I am too weak. I don't have a clue. Just as soon as we call out to God, God is on it. He leans down and he says, I hear you. I've got it. This is amazing that you and I, small, puny, weak, sinful little human wretches that we are, could have the ear of Almighty God just as soon as we pray. Incredible. And he responds. He doesn't just hand it off to a deputy or a secretary somewhere. He himself is interested intensely. He's going to invest. He's going to intervene. And he does. And so David, back in Psalm 57, says, he will send from heaven and save me, and he will reproach the one who tramples upon me. Notice now that David shares the cause of his grief in verses 4 through 6. It says, my soul is among lions. I must lie among those who breathe forth fire, even the sons of men whose teeth are spears and arrows and their tongue a sharp sword. Who's he talking about? Well, remember, this has a historical background in the cave. He's talking about Saul and Saul's soldiers. Some of them, no doubt, he knew personally because he'd been in the palace. They were his friends. And they used to say, David, we love your harping. You've got such talent. You've got a beautiful voice. We love it when you sing about the Lord. And now they're trying to kill him. He has a cause for grief. But notice, even here in these verses, 4 through 6, look at verse 5. Be exalted above the heavens, O God. Let your glory be above all the earth. Verse 6 is going to pick up again. They, the enemy, have prepared a net for my steps. My soul is bowed down. They dug a pit before me. Verse 5 seems out of place. David, did you mess up? You know, when you're writing this song, did you misplace a stanza? You know, why did you stick it in there? Friends, here's a great truth, a great lesson. In the moment of grief, in the moment of anxiety, in the moment of uncertainty, when the enemy is right at the door, there is no better time to worship God. There's no better time to acknowledge, God, you are exalted. You are in charge. I acknowledge that your plan, what you are doing right now, is good. I don't understand it. Why would Saul think that David is an enemy? David had given no evidence of it whatsoever. Why would God allow that? And yet, David says, be exalted above the heavens. You, Lord, are in charge, and what you're doing is running your plan the way that you see fit. And I'm exalting you, I'm worshiping, I'm praising you right now. There is no better time to worship God than in the moment of anxiety. First of all, because God is always worthy of praise. Secondly, because it helps us screw our head back on straight. You ever go to screw a jar lid on and the threads get a little messed up and you have to play with it and take it off and put it on 5 times? That's what happens with our heads. We get our heads cross-threaded and we're thinking, I got to solve this somehow. I've got to figure this out. It's getting worse instead of better. When really what we need to do is take our head completely off, find the threads, screw it back on with this reality. Be exalted above the heavens, O Lord. You are in charge. You are the king. And whatever you're doing now, I don't have a clue what it is. It makes no sense to me. But you don't have to give an account to me. You're the king. You're in charge. Notice now in verse 7, David's confidence in God. He says, my heart is steadfast, O God, my heart is steadfast. Steadfast means solid, steady, unmoving, unshakable. There's a corollary to this in the New Testament. It occurs a couple of times. Let me just show you one of the references. Go to 1 Corinthians 15, and you're going to recognize it just as soon as you see it. 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, and I would like for us to glance at verse 58. 1 Corinthians 15, 58. This is Brother Nathan's life verse. He loves this verse a lot because it talks about stability. 1 Corinthians 15, 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord. The word therefore at the beginning of the verse clues us in. There's a reason for this. There's a reason for this stability, for this steadfastness, for this immovability, and it's the preceding material. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is real. It happened. And we have victory over sin and death and hell through faith in Christ. He's already won, and so what we have now is a steadfast certainty that what we do in this life matters to God. It's important. It counts. It means something because of what Jesus Christ has done for us on the cross and coming out of the grave. Back in Psalm 57, David says in verse 7, my heart is steadfast, O God. He's been singing to the Lord about his confidence in the Lord. He's been saying, I've got enemies. They're like lions. Their teeth are like spears and swords. But I am counting on you. I take refuge under the shadow of your wings. I call to you and you hear me. And so he goes on to say in verse 8, awake my glory, awake harp and lyre. I will awake in the dawn. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. One of the things that is supposed to happen as we grow through a period of uncertainty and anxiety, as we come out the other side of a time of testing, a time of trial, one of the things that's supposed to happen is that we have a testimony. We have the ability to tell other people, I want to tell you now, this time period that I went through, it was really rugged. I didn't know what to do. I didn't have the strength. I did not have the capability. But I called out to my God. I asked the Lord for help. I acknowledged that He is in charge. And God came through for me. We're supposed to have a testimony. We're supposed to have a witness. We're supposed to be able to tell people a story, a real story, a real historical narrative. This is what happened to me. Here's my experience. And now let me tell you what God has done for me, how He has intervened in my life, and how He delivered me from difficulty, from death, from hardship. And so David says, I will give thanks in verse 9. I will sing praises. Verse 10, for your loving kindness is great to the heavens and your truth to the clouds. You may have noticed that is an exact duplicate, or a near exact duplicate of verse 3, the end of the verse, loving kindness and truth. These two characteristics, loving kindness, is grace, mercy, compassion, all rolled into one. The second word, which the New American Standard translates as truth, that's probably not the best translation. Perhaps faithfulness is a better one. Your loving kindness and your faithfulness are exalted and to the clouds. Verse 11 is kind of a refrain. It's a repeated chorus is back from verse 5. Be exalted above the heavens, O God, let your glory be above all the earth. David learned about trusting in God. And we too need to remember to take refuge in the shadow of God's wings. Right now, think of all the poor, benighted creatures out there in the world who have no refuge. They have no one to turn to. They're looking for some comfort. They're looking for some hope somewhere, and they're coming up empty. By the grace of God, because of God's great love, we have a refuge. We can turn to the Lord. We can say, Lord, I'm in the shadow of your wings. Thank you. And we also should remember right now, while the uncertainty and the anxiety are running at record high levels, we should remember to worship the Lord. Worship him, not put it off, not say, well, when we get through this, then I'll worship. No, worship the Lord now. Do be ready to share your testimony. Be ready to tell other people. How can you smile when they ask that question? You should be able to answer, I've got a refuge. I have a protection. I have a Savior. And that's how I can have peace. Let's be on the lookout, even though we're practicing social distancing. That is a term that I did not even know until about 2 weeks ago. Even though we're practicing that distance, be on the lookout for how we might be able to be a blessing to people who do not know the Lord. Thank you for being with us. We do have an evening service, unless the governor issues a proclamation this afternoon. And the evening service is at 5 o'clock tonight. Our subject for study is Genesis chapters 10 and 11. Please stand with me. We'll dismiss in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you that we can find refuge in the shadow of your wings. Thank you that you are so reliable, you are so gracious and compassionate, that even when the anxiety threatens to choke us, we can turn to you and know that you have heard us, you do deliver, you do answer. Oh Lord, we thank you that you are on high and your kingdom is still running, you are still in charge of everything, and we trust in you. We pray for people who are suffering, we pray for people who are anxious and cannot find any hope or help anywhere. Oh, Lord, that you might place in their lives some information about the gospel of Jesus Christ, that they would be able to turn to Jesus Christ in faith and be rescued. Oh, Lord, thank you for your grace to us. Dismiss us now with your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. We are dismissed.